I have with me Dr. Shrisham Aiya. Shrisham Aiya is the chief, one of the leading cardiologist of Narayana Hrudayalaya. Sai Leela is the imaging expert. Sai Leela is in Miat Hospital, which I was working about 7-8 years ago. This is a patient with a sinus venosus AST. So the purpose of this presentation today is to demonstrate how we plan a covered stent exclusion of a sinus venosus AST and try to achieve a non-surgical closure of a sinus venosus AST with a covered stent. The basic principle is superior vena cava drains into the right atrium. The posterior wall of the superior vena cava has got a hole, and the right upper pulmonary vein drains into that SVC-RA junction. The hole represents the unroofing of the anterior wall of the right upper pulmonary vein. So the hole is actually the unroofed hole of the right upper pulmonary vein. So when you pass a balloon through the inferior vena cava into the superior vena cava, your balloon is anterior to the hole. When you inflate the balloon, you are occluding that hole. The surface of the balloon is going to occlude the hole. The right upper pulmonary vein, which is draining into the dilated lower part of the superior vena cava, will now find the balloon not able to enter into the superior vena cava. So it will take a posterior path and go into the left atrium. So now we have the ways of doing it. There are three different schools. The first school is from Houston. What they do in Texas is they will take a 3D CT. They will make a 3D print of the model. Once they take a 3D print, they will implant a stent graft. None of the covered stents, like covered CP stent or covered Advanta XL or covered Andra, is acceptable in US. So they will take a stent graft. The Cook Zenith stent graft or the Medtronic Talent stent graft, which are meant for aortic aneurysms. So they will deploy it in that superior vena cava in an elastic 3D reprint. Then they will probe the right upper pulmonary vein and enter into the left atrium and see the anatomical pathways. If that person is fit on the 3D model, then they take into the lab. The second school is Eric Rosenthal from Guy's Hospital, London. They do a CT, they do a 3D reprint. They put a covered CP stent which is customized. It's a 10-zig CP stent. What we normally have in India is a 8-zig CP stent. The covered 8-zig CP stent should not be expanded beyond 22 millimeters after 22 fabric breaks. So you can stent a 8-zig only to 22. So you need a 10-zig. So 10-zig is not manufactured routinely, and you have to custom order. So once you have a 10-zig CP stent, you need to get the full length of the superior vena cava, starting above the pulmonary vein, coming below up to the and cross the border of the sinus venosus AST. So the 10-zig CP stent should hang like an elephant trunk within the right atrium. So this is the basic principle. So we have been doing this now on about 30 patients so far, and we have evolved our techniques slowly, step by step. In the initial phases, the reason for us to choose this strategy was, in patients who are grown up, sinus venosus ASD with severe pulmonary hypertension, early pulmonary vascular disease, however still having 2:1 or 2.5:1 shunt, and having a PVR of 5-6, if we thought in these particular patients, if we avoid a cardiopulmonary bypass, we may be able to prevent a post-operative PAH surges, we follow the close and straight strategy. So they will be on pulmonary vasodilators, you maintain them and look at periodically what is their PAH. This is how we started. Then when we did a test balloon occlusion on these patients, the pulmonary artery pressure, which will originally be 60 to 70, when you do the test balloon occlusion will drop down to 40, indicating the so-called patients with 2:1 or 2.5:1 shunt but PVR index of 6 Wood units, who will be borderline candidates, on a test balloon occlusion acutely drop their PA pressures without a corresponding drop in the aortic pressures and cardiac output to 40s and all, which will make the surgeons, everybody feel comfortable. In such a patient, then we thought, why don't we put a covered stent on the top? That is how this idea started. This was started about 6 years ago and we have been working on this. Today, I'm going to show the basic steps first. Now, I'm sure Dr. Snehal, Bharat are all there. There may be some questions. So I'm happy to take up the questions and then show the technique.
Yes, questions from Dr. Snehal.
Hi, Vaishiva, as you rightly said, I am sure that this pole is not just like a two dimension. So unless you image in three dimensions, I don't think we can take them. So are you studying them with a CT, the three dimensions?
Dr. Snehal, your mic is not very great.
Hello?
I am not able to hear.
Sir,
hello.
Sir,
are you able to hear now?
Hello, Shiva, are you able to listen?
I don't know.
Yeah.
Hello.
Slightly reduce the voice so that.
Hello.
You are able to hear?
Am I audible?
A lot of noise behind.
Lot of.
Hello.
Yeah, now clear, better.
Hello.
Yes, I'm hearing you.
Yeah. So I just want to know, are you doing the CT for 3D imaging for all these defects so that we can have a complete assessment? That is one thing. And second thing, what is the age and the size of the patients which you are looking at? Are they elderly patients or even the small kids?
Young children.
Because I am one way
okay.
concerned
question
about
number
the,
one.
Okay.
No, go ahead. Third question also. Go ahead. Then I will answer.
No, in a small kids, if you put a little bigger stent, I'm concerned about compression of the right upper pulmonary vein as well.
Okay. So three questions. First question, are you doing it in small patients? No, we don't do. We don't try to do. We try to take this only in patients who are quite grown up. Sometimes people who are like adults who We may think that they may be candidates of left ventricular restrictive physiology after closure, or patients who are in the working age group who are like engineers and all who cannot stay away for 2 months post-operative stay in their houses, or premarital ladies, some social, some occupational, some elderly age-related issue, some comorbidity, mostly adults. Having said that, there was a child, the smallest that I have done is 6 years. The parents, after we told that there is a sinus venosus ASD and a PAPVC, RARV is getting dilated, this is the correct age to get operated, you should get operated. They said, no, I don't want an operation, whatever be the reason, I will allow my child to keep on going permanently with the sinus venosus ASD because he is asymptomatic. And then we said the natural history is not good. So like, you know, slowly he will develop atrial dilatation. They were not accepting. We did a closure. 6 years was the youngest that I have done. After six, it is 20-year-old girl who is premarital. So I don't encourage younger children. But there may be a situation in a clinical practice where he will come across a correct candidate for a closure of sinus venosus ASD who is 5 years or 6 years, the parents will say, I won't accept now. I am not going to accept even a 10 year or 15 years. Still my child becomes sick. In that particular case, there may be an indication. To the general crowd, I will say, no, don't think about it in children. Question number one. Question number two. The second question is, the right upper pulmonary vein, you are now putting in a stent, and whether with a further dilatation of the stent in future, will you be causing a pulmonary venous obstruction? It may be occluding today. Now, my feeling is, if I put a covered stent in the superior vena cava, the covered stent is clinging on to the edges of the sinus venous society and closing it today, I will not post-dilate these patients. I will try to achieve a good adult-sized superior vena cava today itself. Most of the time what happens is, if the basic SVC is 20 millimeter, we will end up in putting 26 millimeter, there won't be a need for any further dilatation. So if I am not occluding on table, there is no occlusion later. It will be, everything is seen on table. Second question. Third question, I forgot, Sneha.
Do you do 3D imaging for all the patients, like the
okay,
CT assessment?
Okay, yeah, yeah, sorry, I got it. 3D, see the 3D CT scan, if I have to do, number one, it costs 10,000 rupees. After they get the 3D data, I analyze it and I find that it is suitable, I still have to do a test balloon occlusion. Now, if I do a test balloon occlusion, and if I have on table in my hospital permanently a long custom 10-zig CP stent, I can deploy it on the same day. However, after the test balloon occlusion only, I will know what is the diameter, what is the length. Then I order. Then it comes after 2 months. So for me, it's CT scan, cath for test balloon occlusion, procedure, 3 days. So I take away the first one. I don't do a CT. I did it meticulously in the first 10 cases. I got all the informations, but then I felt that information is just additional, because anyhow I am going test balloon occlusion. You can argue for one thing. There are patients where the right upper pulmonary vein was draining very superiorly, high into the superior vena cava, which we cannot identify by echo or by transesophageal. Then in that patient, when I do the test balloon occlusion, I will discover that it is high. I could have avoided a test balloon occlusion by doing a CT. So if you are in the ideal situation, evaluate the patient with echocardiogram one. If the age permits, transesophageal echo next. If cost permits, CT scan three. If the patient is accepting this test balloon occlusion, that means an experiment to see whether he is suitable for, and fifth is the procedure.
Of patients who have bilateral SVCs with sinus venosus defect, where right SVC is really going to be small. So, whether you exclude these patients completely?
Yes. No. In fact, they are preferred. The actually, if it is a bilateral superior vena cava, the right superior vena cava often is 15 to 16 millimeter. Most of the time we will be able to get a complete occlusion with a 20 or 22 millimeter covered stent. Now we are getting into the 8-zig CP stent. So 8-zig CP stent may be acceptable. So in fact, if I have two SVCs, I am happy. If I have only one superior vena cava, I am unhappy, because it goes to 28.
Yeah, sir, one more question regarding the size of the sinus venosus defect. On the exclusion criteria, from the RA border, how much below the stent should be, or hanging stent into the RA, you have the caution?
Superb question. Who is this, Sanjay Khatri?
No, this is Dr. Lalit Lavankar. I had this question because I have attempted one sinus venosus defect in a 12 years lady, similar indication you said about the social and all that. I had the written consent of the parents
also. Lalit, excellent question. On a transesophageal echocardiogram, superior vena cava is there. Sailila, can you show the echo first picture, your first picture? Go echo live. Okay, so you see, this is the sinus venous association. Freeze it, Dr. Sailila.
We cannot see echo.
Freeze it. Oh, no, one second. We'll get you. Echo live. Echo big. Boss, echo big. Okay, cameraman, come inside.
Now we are seeing, sir.
Okay, you make it brighter. Sailila, make it brighter. Okay, fine. Now you put a pointer and show the caudal edge of the sinus venosus ASD. You see, Dr. Sailila is now showing the caudal edge of the sinus venosus ASD. The vertical length of the sinus venosus ASD should not be longer than the diameter of the superior vena cava. That means it is having a caudal extension. If there is a caudal extension, this is not suitable.
Okay.
So the sinus venosus ASD maximum can extend about 15 to 20 millimeter, not more than that. If it is extending like 35 millimeter down, it is not suitable.
Yes.
Shiva, one more question.
Shall I show some of the steps?
Shiva, one more question.
Doctor.
Yes.
Kalyana syndrome.
No, you said severe PAH. If you do a occlusion, BP will drop drastically. What weight is different from large ASD with severe PAH compared to this one?
In large secondum ASD also, if there is a hyperkinetic pulmonary hypertension, you go and test balloon occlude that ASD and you put in a parallel catheter in the pulmonary artery, truly in many patients there is a fall in PA pressure. Even though we will say an ASD level shunt will take a longer time for the PA pressure to be reflected, a ductus arteriosus where we do balloon occlusion regularly will show instantaneous fall. In every hypertensive ASD, if you go and occlude, if that patient is having a large left-right shunt with a hyperkinetic PAH, there is a fall in PA pressure. I have seen it many times.
Yeah, yeah. I also.
In fact, in sinus venosus ASDs.
Yeah, yeah.
Exactly. Yeah, I'm sure we all are the same.
Is it anyway different from that one? I'm just asking because we also have some SV steps, sinus venosus, PAH, so just keeping on, medications. Just want to know whether it's different from that one, asthma secondum is PAH from this one. Sinus.
Check the ACT once and check whether hemoglobin is, if ACT is adequate. One more thing, let me tell you. In fact, in patients who are having, I heard the talk on PDA operability. I want to tell, in patients with atrial septal defect, if you have a shunt of 1.5:2:1 and the PVR is touching 6, very often in a grown-up patient, we feel that that is not a good candidate. So in those candidates, before branding them as inoperable at that current time and starting on pulmonary vasodilators and reassessing 6 months or 1 year or 2 years later, I also do a balloon occlusion. If on a test balloon occlusion, if the PA pressure drops down to almost normal, like 30, 35 systolic, sometimes I take a decision to go ahead and operate on that same go also. So test balloon occlusion is a very powerful strategy in PDA, but in ASD also it may be an acceptable one more criteria for deciding operability.
And one more question. This is regarding the same sinus venous ASD. We also once we tried, took the patient to cath lab, and we did, and you showed pulmonary vein, cytoplasm is one more coming up, almost relatively, both all of upper lobe was draining. Just came out because of, thinking that it cannot close that.
Correct. Correct. I think these are the anatomical variations. Let us now go into the technique because your time is also going low. I will show Sailila, can you describe? Sailila, do you have a mic?
One question.
Oh, sorry.
Quick question.
Yeah. Yes.
Sir, what about the sinus node anatomy in sinus venosus ASD and chance of compression upon the sinus node artery?
Sinus node anatomy.
SVC and RHH.
Thank you for asking.
So we are going to put a stent there at
okay. In a sinus node, in a sinus venosus surgical closure, you do a longitudinal cut on the superior vena cava RA junction. The sinus nodal artery either has an anterior loop or a posterior loop. You may cut it out, you may not recognize, and that leads to sinus nodal dysfunction. In a sinus venosus ASD covered stenting, you are internally stretching it. The chances of a serious sinus nodal artery ischemia, I feel, is less likely. We have not had any occurrences of any significant sinus disturbances after the sinus venosus ASD.
The mechanical node is also there at the SVCR junction.
Sir,
Sinus node itself is a tertiary artery.
Srinivas, I'm telling
that is a location for the.
I feel the stretch is not going to create a problem. It is the vascular injury caused by a longitudinal cut. That is the injury. Yeah, I mean, if you ask me whether I have done the sinus nodal artery injections, no, never.
Thank you. Proceed with.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Dr. Srisham Iyer is an electrophysiologist. He says that when he burns a sinus nodal reentrant tachycardia, it takes a lot of time. Okay, now in order to save time, I will go fast. Show fluoro, Vic. Fluoro. Okay, so the first step is take a jugular access, take a femoral access, and get an artery vena venous loop. Next step is take an arterial catheter, go through the LV, LA, right upper pulmonary vein, make an injection, record the pressures, right upper pulmonary vein is draining into the SVC RA junction, most of the blood is going into the right atrium, right ventricle, pulmonary artery. Next picture, do the same injection in LAO cranial projection. What is seen on the left side of the screen is the right atrium. What is seen on the right side of the screen is the left atrium. We see only filling of the left side of the screen, which means only right upper pulmonary vein, SVC, RA, RV. Next picture, test balloon. This is a 28 millimeter, 6 centimeter long balloon, which is straddling the pulmonary venous entry site. What we are seeing is pulmonary vein fills, left atrium fills, the contrast reflexes into the right lower pulmonary vein. Freeze it. Okay, just go back. You can see the contrast reflexing into the right lower pulmonary vein. Come this side, come this side. No, forward.
Yes, sir.
Previous? Yeah, that is the right lower pulmonary vein. So basically what we see is right upper pulmonary vein fills the LA. LA reflexes into the right lower pulmonary vein. Run it now. And there is not much of filling of the right atrium.
At this time your ASD is also
seen well? Yeah, I will show that. Actually, Sai Leela is going to show you those things later. Now I'm showing the fluoroscopic part because I can not combine both. Next. Okay. This is a left anterior oblique projection. When we do here, most of the blood is actually going into the left atrium. You can see a small puff into the right atrium. Let us see it. Can you see that?
Yes.
In fact, that is not the right upper, that's the right lower pulmonary vein. Yeah. So sorry, we felt that there was a small puff, but actually there is no puff. It's the sinus venous AC is completely occluded. Next picture. Chiva. We pushed this balloon a little bit above.
Chiva, can I ask a question? Chiva.
Yes. Chiva. Yeah, I'm listening.
Yeah.
Dr. Suresh. Pigtail.
Or with what? Yeah, with pigtail. What is the pressure in that when you are balloon occluding? Do you look at it?
I'm going to show next that also. I'm going to show. Everything is going to be shown. Just, okay. So this is a 28 millimeter balloon, little bit advanced higher. And this is the flow completely into the left atrium now. Next picture. That's all. Okay. The pressure, show the pressure big now. Hemodynamic big. Hemodynamic. Okay, make it big. The right upper pulmonary vein pigtail is continuously recording the pressure, and now it is mean of 15, and it was the same 15 to 16 on balloon occlusion also. You see now I have deflated. Now Sai Leela will show the balloon. Straight away go to the balloon. Echo big.
We cannot see. Yes.
Echo big. One second. Yeah, she will show the exact point. Which is the balloon? Is this the balloon? Okay. Let's go back. The balloon. You see now, this is the balloon. And basically, what we are getting is, the balloon is occluding the SVC-RA junction. The blue color that you are seeing at the caudal edge of the balloon is actually the inferior vena cava blood that comes, skirts around the lower end of the balloon. There is no color that is crossing the sinus venosus ASD at the SVCRA junction. Then she turns rightward. Show the next picture. So then this is the right upper pulmonary vein flow. Some of the persons may have a concern that it is looking subtly turbulent, it's looking subtly, brighter in color. Basically, we need to remember the previously the pulmonary vein was coming like a completely a open pathway into a open cavity. Now that pulmonary vein comes and hits against the balloon. Then it posteriorly reroutes itself and gets into the LA. So when that is going to be creating something like a turbulence, like for example, how the Fontan circuit goes when the conduit, how it turns into the pulmonary artery. So there may be some flow energy losses and all here. However, what we are interested is it remaining laminar with a velocity of less than 1 meter per second, and is it creating the same pressures in the pulmonary vein on a balloon occlusion? So these are the things that we do. Next picture. So this is the right upper pulmonary vein. Next. This is the first occlusion. Next. Okay. Then next. This is the second occlusion. Next. So this is, you can see that again there is a complete occlusion on the sinus venosus ASD. So this is where we have completed right now. So the next step will be, we have to mount some stent on a 28 millimeter balloon. Now show fluorobic.
One quick question, sir. The catheter in the right up
yes.
Pulmonary vein, we have passed it retrogradely across the mitral valve. Is it feasible to just take one more venous access and directly enter that? Is there a difference between these two?
We were doing the same thing in our first 20 cases. What we will do is, when there is a small catheter that is preventing the sinus venosus margins from hugging the balloon, there will be a small residual flow. And we will think that small residual flow is created by inadequate occlusion. But that will be truly because this catheter is going across. Then once we started adopting this strategy, wherein we are not crossing the sinus venosus ASD into the pulmonary vein, the catheter just goes from the LA into the pulmonary vein, it actually gives us a sort of confidence. The catheter is going in the place where it is destined to go. So we feel very comfortable here.
One more suggestion. Stop keeping this what you have kept as a pigtail. You can inject from the left pulmonary artery, then see the flow. You can see the flow after the rest occlusion. Number two, you can say wedge.
You can say that it is right upper pulmonary artery branch. We did that also. We did that also, but unfortunately we cannot measure the pressure. So actually, Kalyan, this is evolved over some 32 patients. So lots of modifications over a period of time. We have done many things on this. And this is, as of today, the technique that we follow. We may change it over a period of time. This right upper pulmonary artery injection was some of the very, very early things that we were doing. Now we have stopped doing that, because the amount of contrast that I have to inject into the right upper pulmonary artery is a little bit more. And second thing is, many contrast will spill into the right lower and waste that injection. So this is more evolution. Now, one more thing, Dr. Kalyan, you are supposed to be here for a PDA closure. I think if you start now only, you'll be able to reach here.
You're so far-sighted.
Can I stop here and give it to the other lab? Other lab is ready?
Sir, yeah. The length
Kamlan
of the
is
stent,
ready
sir.
With
Shivakumar, sir.
Okay. Now we are thinking about a stent that should be going for at least 6 centimeters, because this is a 6 centimeter balloon. And the stent should be dilatable to 28 millimeter. So we are thinking about it. I am thinking about a custom CP stent, 10 zig, 7 centimeter,
Chiba,
which will foreshorten to 55 millimeter.
That diameter,
so
how heavy, Joe?
Yeah.
The
I have done actually a pre testing in this patient about 2 weeks ago. During that time, I started with a 22 balloon, then 25 balloon, and 28 balloon, and only 28 occluded.
So you're looking at the balloon size that will cause a complete occlusion.
Correct.
And the way the SPC will hold on to that stent without dropping it, is there any way of predicting it?
Since this balloon is gripping, I feel the stent also will be gripped. With all prayers.
Balloon mounted stent or a self-expanding stent?
Okay, that is what I was telling. The Houston group uses stent grafts. The problem about a stent graft is it's more expensive. Yeah, 6 centimeter or an 8 centimeter stent graft is roughly 4.5 to 5 lakhs. It's a 24 French compatible sheath, so 24 venous access. We are not the doctors who usually use an aortic stent graft. We use more often a balloon expandable stent. So the English, Guy's Hospital, Eric Rosenthal, like our center, we all use balloon expandable. Houston, Texas, USA uses stent graft because stent grafts are acceptable in USA.
Cost of this graft, sir? Cost of this stent, sir, CP stent?
Variable. Variable. If it is a custom CP stent, it comes to 4.5 lakhs.
Okay.
If it is a 22 millimeter CP, regular CP stent, then it will come to about 2.5 lakhs. If it is a covered Andra stent, it comes to 1.8 lakhs. Variable.
Shiva, I'm Amitav here.
Yes.
Yeah, I just wanted to Amitav. Ask. Yeah, good morning. I just wanted to ask regarding the fact that when you are closing this ASD with a covered stent, then what is the length of the distance from the innominate vein which would make you feel comfortable about the stability of the stent? I mean the entry of the innominate into the
band
SVC.
Band on the height.
Yeah. I mean,
yeah,
is
the
there
top, topmost.
So is there any criteria where it will make us feel comfortable where that's a minimum length required for the stability of the stent? Because the entry of the innominate into the SVC might be very variable. So is that a criteria which we should
Correct.
Always take
so
into account?
The whenever we position the stent, we will ensure that we are almost flush with the innominate vein.
Okay.
So over to Kannan on the other lab.
You have one question I have. Do you have any?
Yes, Dr. Bharat.
Do you have any issues with oversizing the stent? Why I'm asking?
I don't know whether we can call it oversizing.
No.
Because
do you have any
only at 28 millimeter it is occluding.
Correct. Then why do you want to put 28? Why not a 30 or a 32?
I don't have.
No, on a 30 bib.
It's not available.
30 bib is not available. I was under the impression 30 bib is available.
No.
Largest is 28?
No. What is commercially available today, the largest custom CP stent that the NewMed company makes and distributes to us
is
28.
Okay.
And moreover,
then they will customize that also, and that cost will also get added.
You know, your oversize, it may compress your pulmonary vein also, no? If you oversize more than the adequate. I think you have to inflate slowly and look for the flow. TE flow, then we stop it. It's like stop flow, it's a technique.
No, the size of the balloon is the size of the stent. So shall we go to the other lab? Okay, this is where I left you. The balloon was 28 millimeter. The right upper pulmonary vein injection was showing a flow predominantly into the left atrium. Next picture. So the next picture is, we try to see where the innominate vein is, and in the same position where we inflated, this is the height of innominate vein. The next step that we did, next. This is a custom 10-zig covered CP, 7.5 centimeter, I don't have a 28x8 balloon now. The previous balloon that I used was 28x6 Bova balloon. So I mounted the 7.5 stent on the 28x6. So there is 7.5 millimeter here and 7.5 millimeter there beyond the dots. But that is also reasonably cylindrical. So now what we did, we positioned it. We looked at right upper pulmonary vein injection and we tried to see whether the pulmonary vein is coming on the side of the stent. Next picture. Then we made a top injection. In the top injection, we are not occluding the innominate vein. Next picture. I pushed it a little bit more higher in order to get more stability. In this particular position, actually more of the stent is in the superior vena cava, but I have a doubt whether the lower end will be flush with the sinus venosus ASD, and we need to remember that this particular stent will foreshorten. So next picture, I again pulled it marginally down, run this whole sequence. So this is a 28x6 Bova balloon, inflated by Dr. Srishamaya, monitored by Dr. Sai Leela, slowly getting separated. First we went up to 25. So when we reached 25, it is like a cylinder. Now Dr. Srisha is giving more and more. The lower end is becoming 28. Upper end in the superior vena cava still remains at 25. And at this point, we start deflating. Next picture. So then, run it. So we deflated. So now the next step. Right upper pulmonary vein, we are injecting. We find a small residual flow that is skirting on the right edge of the stent. But most of the pulmonary veins are committed into the right left atrium. Next picture. LAO view. Most of the flow is into the LA, and in this particular view, not much of RA filling. Show hemodynamics live. Big screen hemodynamics. By the time we were actually getting the stent prepared, the pulmonary venous pressures were somewhere around 17. Now the pressure is somewhere around 20. Now, suppress the aorta now. Suppress the aorta. I'll show only the waveforms. Suppress the aorta. Okay. Take out the mean line also. If you carefully look at this picture, the A waves are prominent and the X descent is prominent. An indicator of marginal left ventricular restrictive physiology that is seen in slightly older children. I will now show the echo. Sai Leela is now showing echo live. Is it live or recorded? Live. Okay, now this is, so this is the covered stent color. So there is no residual flow that is seen from the LA into the RA. Now Dr. Sai Leela will slowly rightward torque into the right pulmonary vein. The color is looking laminar. She will now do a pulse wave Doppler, and that is a pulse wave Doppler. This prominent A wave reversals, atrial systolic reversals, is a reflector of borderline LV restrictive physiology that is creating a prominent atrial systolic flow reversal. The mean gradients are less than 1 meter per second. Dr. Sai Leela is tracing something like that. Yes. So it is like a negligible number, 2 millimeters of mercury. So show again the pulmonary venous orifice. So this is the pulmonary venous orifice. My pigtail is through that. So now what I'm going to do is take a thermo wire. I'm going to slowly withdraw my pigtail out. Pigtail? I mean, soften. Oh, sure. Actually, Dr. Kannan wants to show one angiogram.
Final.
Okay, sure, yeah, please go ahead. Go ahead. Switch to the other lab.
Yes, we can see you, Dr. Kannan.
Yeah, show the angiogram. Just to complete the angiogram. So we have done next. Yeah. See, this is the pigtail angiogram. It is showing a very good opposition. There's a very small space behind the stent posteriorly, but that's fine. All other areas are well opposed. The PDA stump is still seen. Okay, next. It's an anteroposterior projection also is very stable. So we have finished the procedure. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you. That was good applause to you. Switch back to the other lab. We are back, Shiva.
We live?
Yes, we can see you.
Yeah. So now fluoro big now. Show the sequence of pulmonary, like the vein. Did you record? Or else I'll show here. Okay, now my catheter is in the LV. Show the hemodynamics big. Increase the speed. Muhammad, yes, okay. Now you see that the end-diastolic shoulder, show the hemodynamics big. End-diastolic shoulder is higher. The patient is also marginally hypertensive. Sister, give 40 milligram Lasix. More or less something similar to what Biswajit got yesterday. You know, yeah, a restrictive LV physiology is getting manifest. We can manage it medically with pharmacological agents. 40 Lasix IV, stop the IV fluid. So now, Dr. Sai Leela's echo. Echo big. Dr. Sai Leela, now start showing. You are holding that. Now, show fluoro, Dr. Maya. You keep showing. So Dr. Sai Leela is now showing the laminar left upper pulmonary venous flows on a long axial view. Can you show that on a short axis view also, 0 degree? I'll drag it. Yeah. Sister, RCA catheter. 0 degree. That is the covered stent. That circular structure is the covered stent. Now, rightward torque and show the right upper pulmonary vein. That is the right upper pulmonary vein. Now, you see that the right upper pulmonary vein comes and hits the wall of the covered stent and escapes into the posterior left atrium. Srisha says it is looking better. No, but it is rather an unobstructed flow. Is the pictures clear there?
Yes, sir.
Very
we can
clear.
See.
Excellent.
So now what we are doing, this is a stiff wire that is going from the right inferior vena cava to right superior vena cava. So I want to take that out safely. Release the clamp. So I have got a catheter now, and I have taken it out. I am taking out the whole thing. Now the last step of this, which is actually sort of redundant, because this 28 millimeter covered CP will never obstruct the superior vena cava, but I will still inject into the superior vena cava.
Dr. Shiva, quick question regarding length. How much
take from the upper margin to lower margin, how you decide three before ordering the stent in a given patient?
Actually, we need a good anchor in the superior vena cava.
Inferiorly, how much it should
start? So we need to have something like around 2.5 centimeter above. And then below the caudal edge of the sinus venosus ASD, we need to have another 2.5 centimeter below. If the pulmonary vein width is around 2.5 centimeter, then the total length is 7.5 centimeter.
Okay. I think that is even clear.
But then you should remember 7.5 centimeter will foreshorten.
So to R more
marginally.
Sir, it becomes 55. It shortens by 20 centimeter, 20 mm.
This is actually a 7.5 centimeter long stent. One of my colleague will maybe sometime later tell you what is the true length today.
Chiba.
So now I am pulling it back from the LV into the aorta. Yes, Dr. Suresh.
Chiba, you have that line from above. You were using it only for angio, or did you use that veno-venous loop to hold on to the wire while deploying, like Shack recommends?
Yeah. Completely. Completely holding it.
You were holding it.
Yeah, no, I was not holding. My great colleague, Dr. Shakavat Alam from Bangladesh, who has been with me for the last 2 years. He's the assistant professor of pediatric cardiology from BSMMU, Bangladesh. And he was the person who was controlling it. In fact, he was giving a tension on the wire when I was inflating, so that accidentally we don't give a slack on the wire. Dr. Alam has seen about 15, 16 cases stitch.
Shiva Chaitanya, can I ask you a question, please?
Yeah.
Shiva, can you
yeah,
hear
go
me?
Ahead, please.
Shiva Chaitanya.
Yeah, Chaitan, very well.
Yeah. Fantastic demonstration of how to do a difficult case like this. I think I saw you last year doing a live case for CSI as well. My question to you is about what imaging modality do you use for follow-up of these patients?
You came late, Chetan. You had a good sleep and came late?
No, I was here from the start.
Okay.
I said follow-up.
Okay, people will say, like for example, Eric Cross, follow-up is transesophageal echo.
Just transit. So when do you do that transesophageal echo? How often do you do it, and when do you do it after? Like, if you've done this for this patient today, will you do it in 3 months, 6 months, 1 year?
One month first, 6 months next, 1 year later.
And would you consider doing a CT scan?
What is a CT scan? No. I did it. I did all these things in the first 10 cases. Now I have stopped giving radiation more than what I have given in the lab. I want to show the figure of eight how I take. Please come here. Come closer. See, people all will take this is a two silk. Come closer, bus. So you look here. You have to come
size?
Closer. Take it out.
The sheet size, what was it?
24. Actually, this needs only an 18 French sheet, but I don't have an 18 French sheet, so I am taking a 24. The largest sheet that I have is 16 French. After 16, I don't have. Okay, now zoom in. I'll show you how. See, the normal figure of eight, there is one stitch that goes below the sheath, I'll explain, and one stitch that goes above. But when you finally tie, your strength is not good, and what will happen is the stitch will get cut in your under your finger. So I go through the same holes again, and this is now double figure of eight. That means there are two stitches together, two silks together. Now you see this. I am cutting this out. Now, I have two here. I have two here. If you look at the tower analogy, they will say they will take two proglides. Because they don't trust one will be good enough. Come this side, Alan. Or Maya. Maya, can. No, can you pull out here? Alan will come to the top. Table drop. Yeah. I'm tightening it. Yeah, keep on pulling it. Okay. Now, press it nicely. I have to take a stitch. So now, in this tightening step, if I have a single two silk, sometimes it'll just cut. Take it out. So now when I have two stitches, the strength increases. So I strongly recommend two stitches when you are taking figure of eight.
This is 2-0, is it?
Two, not 2-0. Two, two.
Two.
There is no zero.
That is quite thick, I think.
So it's thicker than 2-0.
Yeah,
it's quite thick, but still it will cut. So,
Dr. Shiva, if we are having...
So I'm giving a manual compression.
Next session.
Oh, perfect. You go ahead. Go ahead, please. Next. Yeah, yeah. Yeah.
Or if we can have the four-chamber view echo, if possible, even the transthoracic will do.
Which push pressure? Yeah, shift into...
Shiva, there is a request for a transthoracic
yes?
or a four-chamber view which will demonstrate the SVC
oh, okay. Okay, okay.
To
four chamber
RA
view.
Flow.
Dr. Sai Leela, can you give the transthoracic probe? Dr. Archana?
Yes.
Yeah, I will just locate the transesophage transthoracic probe. I am not seeing in the machine now.
Okay.
You wanted to see the four chamber view, right?
Yes, you could even do it through with the TE, but that would not adequately.
TE probe has also come out. Just give me 1 minute.
Okay.
I'm getting the four chamber view.
Yes, on the
transthoracic.
How the strength
exactly.
Looks into the RA.
That would look really promising, surely.
Yeah, get it. Just, somebody has gone to get it, within 1 minute it will be there.
Thank you.
So by that time we can call upon the next set of speakers, if you don't mind, we'll be fast tracked.